Thank you everyone for joining today me on this talk. I'm going to talk you about my experience as a remote worker and as a remote manager. 10 years ago, I joined Red Hat in a very internal subsystem of our middleware application server as a developer. And already joined 10 years ago as a full remote worker. My family and my friends thought I was crazy switching to a 100% remote working. I remember that mom told me, you will be so isolated, you will turn mad, period. Well, 10 years later, I'm still here, I'm still a 100% remote worker. And now I have, since a few years, the role of manager of software engineer with a team distributed all over the world, and everyone are working remotely from home. And well, open source culture, open organization principles, and the right mindset permitted me not only to survive to this remote working, but also to have a lot of fun, both as an individual contributor and as manager. Well, but don't get me wrong, has not been always easy. Full remote working and even more remote management require a complete change of mindset. And I can bear witness, changing mindset is one of the biggest challenges you can face in adulthood. Let me start with a real story. I had joined Red Hat for more than 1 year at the time of the story. And my team planned an in-person face-to-face meeting in Beijing. I remember I was so excited when I boarded the China Airlines airplane, both because it was the first opportunity to see my colleagues in person, but also because it was my first time in China. Well, it's a long journey from Italy to Beijing, and in the middle of the night, I felt very thirsty. I really needed some fresh water. I asked the flight attendant for a glass of water, and she kindly brought me one quickly. But I drank, and I was puzzled. Or I would say shocked, because the water was hot, but hotter than the one I normally use for making a cup of tea. But the flight attendant explained to me that it's perfectly normal to serve hot water in China Airlines because of the traditional Chinese medicine. And she also gently tried to persuade me that I should not have fresh water at all. Well, I finally got my glass of fresh water, but I realized that at that very moment, I cannot build my relationship with colleagues relying on everything I think I know, relying on my cultural assumptions. I cannot. I cannot because our background cultures are so different. We grown up in so many different parts of the world with various beliefs and values. What is normal for me, maybe it's not for any of them, and vice versa. So it has been shocking too, because what when you realize and accept that you and your colleagues haven't the same background, and your relationship will be conditioned by that. Well, you can see this from two different perspectives. On one end, we have the value of diversity. Diversity could bring different views, ideas, spotting different problems, and their solving paths. I always say that I'm a lucky leader, having people from 7 different countries 3 different continents, and 40% of them are women. So, believe me, I know what a diversity is. And I would say you don't ever sacrifice this diversity to reach consensus quicker. The consequence is what is called groupthink. An hastily agreed decision stopping completely the innovation. Associates should be always encouraged on bringing their own perspective, their own background to any conversations, because multiple views always favor innovation. And also respecting and appreciating diversity, not only it will make the organization much more competitive, but also it will give associates the personal enrichment coming from a colorful relationship. But there is also the other hand. Diversity and multicultural background could be barriers to communicating, barriers to collaborating. Before you can work together, you must be able to share ideas, to communicate, basically. With so heterogeneous cultures, your risk is that innovation is lost in translation. A common set of values and a common background culture are important, really important, especially when you are already missing something vital, that is non-verbal communication and in-person eye contact. You need something to rely on, something that could be considered normal despite of different background. And that is the organization's culture. An organization culture, in fact, is the glue keeping the team anchored to common values. It makes everyone feel safer because sharing the same values, same goals, and same bold statement. A consequence is that trusting each other is easier when you share values, when you share aspirations, and what you believe. In Redette, our associates sincerely believe our open source culture could really change the world. So, in other words, sharing values, sharing beliefs and hopes, we are sharing the vision of the world we want. And I told you, I'm now a manager since a while, now a few years. And what is the role of a manager or a leader, more generally a leader, in this? Well, it is a challenging one, because it is to catalyze this change from a fragmentation of cultures and the fragmentation of communication style, experience, to what? To a kaleidoscope of different cultures contributing to the organization's one. You need, first of all, to step back a little from checking what people are doing and how people are doing. You need to avoid micromanagement. Instead, show trust in your team, championing the organization culture and sharing values with your teammates will help a lot on building mutual trust. The real role of a leader is to create a context where associates feel listened and appreciated, and where they can find all the whys behind the organization strategy and organization's goal. Embracing the open organization culture will make associates feeling part of a community. A community that really cares about them and about their ideas. Because of that, leaders should actively participate in the organization culture growth and adoption, making associate feel it as the glue I mentioned before. And we come to the full remote team management. Leading a full remote team means also that you cannot rely anymore on three important facilitators that in-person team has. That is time spent together, symbols, and the rituals. Believe me, you will miss at some point the time together in front of a coffee machine, also informal happy hours or formal dinners. But also dressing code, office location, or the game area for the more geek companies are all symbols that you cannot count on. You will miss all the rituals that an office life has. And starting from one of the most important ritual, that is the commute, which really helps a lot many people to switch their mind in a working mode, leaving family problem at home and switching to the working mode. So what? The question is how to solve that? Should you try to mine the in-office experience in a full remote environment? Really? Do you want virtual coffee break online meeting, virtual happy hours online meeting, or even virtual commute online meeting? I read about all of this, but I also read about everyone talking about online meeting fatigue. Well, my 10-year-old remote team has never suffered from online meeting fatigue, but also it hasn't ever pretended to do the same things an office-based team does. Maybe some of those meetings works well for some team. I'm not complaining. Whatever works for your team is great, and you should keep it going, always. But don't try to force them too much if they are full remote. In my experience, full remote workers could perceive this forcing as an invasion of their work-life balance. And believe me, we hate this kind of invasion because it's not easy to get to this balance working fully remotely. And we became overprotective of whatever we reached and sounds reasonable for us and for our family. In fact, leading a full remote team means changing the way you are catalyzing the organization culture, adoption, and love. You have to change your focus from spending time together to the values and bold goals you share, creating also new symbols, new rituals, really suitable for the virtual environment. So let me describe what worked for me and for the team I've been part in the last 10 years, as individual contributors before and as manager then. Basically, everyone in the team, both the leaders and the single contributor, always keep in mind open organization principles, somehow, not necessarily formally, and then focus on 7 critical stuff. I think there is 7 critical stuff to focus. And the first is show passion, because passion is contagious. Show passion for what you do, passion for the values, passion for the open source culture. And show virtual symbols of your passion. Could be a nice mail signature recalling some organization culture stuff, or a profile picture where you proudly wear your red fedora. Be open. The second one is be open. open to new ideas, open to new contributors, open to all opinions of your team and outside of your teams. And look, being truly open is hard, much harder than it could seem. You are a really open person and an open leader when you are able to take open decisions, decisions that are transparent, decisions that are inclusive, and decisions that consider colleagues, contributors, clients, anyone impacted by the decision as your customer. The third pillar is be transparent and be able to adapt. Provide to anyone in the team as much context as possible to understand the whys and the strategy of the organization. Then ask and listen. Give and receive feedback is a gift. And use the feedback to adapt the context, putting everyone in the position for expressing all his or her potential. The fourth, show trust. I already told you about avoiding micromanagement and rely on shared values and open culture as the common base to build a trustful relationship. Even more, think about the team as a community, an open source community of enthusiastic people. And remember, the leader can't have the know-how to make all decisions and innovate. It's not the role of the leader. The role of the leader is to delegate to the right people and to show them trust. The fifth, be inclusive. I care about inclusion, but we need to be intentional about inclusion in a virtual environment. We cannot just nudge a colleague or getting involved in a quick chat, maybe during a coffee break. But look, being intentional move inclusion on a deeper, more interesting level. Because in a full remote environment, you will never feel the inclusion just happen. But you feel that someone really cares about you, about your ideas, and intentionally include you in their team, discussion, or project. Rituals. Create rituals favoring inclusion. It's very important. Something that could be a regular weekly call for each project with an open agenda and open discussion. Also regular retrospective after each milestone to collect feedback. Or could even be something not related to day-by-day job, something like a virtual book club to talk with your associate of soft skills. But remember that need rituals. Whatever you select, use a regular, reliable schedule. And regarding content of this, try, ask for feedback, refine, and repeat. The sixth, create connections, don't just connect. Indeed, to work successfully in a virtual environment, we have to pay special attention to the humans on the other side of the screen. We don't just need to be connected, but we need to create connection between humans. Some example, one-to-one video meeting are important to create a relationship between a remote associate, indeed. The important part is be consistent and reliable with their schedule. Make them a ritual, not just something that happens But not only video meeting, also synchronous media, like emails or chat or whatever you want to use, could create connection. The key is not the media. The key is actively listen to the person behind the media, whichever the media would be. Take care of associate, of your associate, and adapt. Empower your associate, giving them freedom and flexibility to do their best. Promote the courage to innovate and impacting to the organization and to the organization's success. Support them in creating their networks, support them in developing their careers, and listen their needs, listen even their rants. Adapt everything, adapt their roles, adapt their careers, adapt their tasks, even to their aspirations and to their skills. Create a context where they can feel empowered and they love their job. So, in conclusion, after more than 10 years now, almost 11, I can affirm that I survived in a fully remote environment, and I also had a lot of fun. My takeaways from these 10 years are: avoid pretending to mime an in-person experience in a virtual world, and keep in mind open source culture, open organization principles, and open management practices. In short, be open and enjoy diversity throughout the open source culture. Wherever your distributed team or your community is dispersed,